I'm pretty excited when I see the faith of some of the young people today that are just saying, God, I'll go anywhere. I'll do anything. There wasn't a lot of that when I grew up. But what happened with those who did have that spark and that excitement, I saw how the church almost squashed them. And I'm praying for this next generation, for the young people who are just saying, I'll go anywhere, I'll do anything, and they're doing it. They're going overseas, or they're, you know, right where they're at in the inner cities or in their own suburbs, just going, you know, I'm gonna be radical. I'm gonna follow Jesus completely. I want it all. I'm not about the games and about, okay, entertain me to death in the church. I wanna follow Jesus and I wanna experience him. And I guess my challenge to the church is for those that are maybe my age or those who are even further along, it's like, would you set the example for the young people? Because what happened in my generation when we were younger, there were those who were radical, but there weren't people. Once they got married, everything changed. Once they had kids, everything changed. And I'm just praying, oh God, could I be an example of someone who's married and has kids and is still thinking kingdom first? Like saying, you know, like 1 Corinthians 7, those who are married should live as though they're not. There's a sense in which this mission is bigger, and can we still live and take risks and still surrender our lives and say, you know what, it's me, my wife, my family, I want to demonstrate to them, you know what, look, when we follow Christ, yeah, that was a little scary, yeah, that might have been a little dangerous, yeah, that was not the, you know, logical move to make, but God did call us that direction, and let's head that way. And I want my kids to experience what it looks like when we live by faith. But not only that, I want to be an example to the young people to say, you know what, your mission with the Lord doesn't end when you get married and suddenly, oh, well, you're dating, so focus on each other. And oh, it's your first year of marriage, you know, just focus on each other. And oh, you just had a kid, you know what, then take time for that little kid, and until he goes to school, then you'll be free. But then once they're in school, it's like, oh, they're teenagers now, just collect that family together and worry about yourselves. But then you're teaching them this mentality that, again, is not about going out in the harvest and being a worker. It's about, let's protect our family now, let's keep us safe, let's find some gated community, and, you know, and keep them all in our house away from all the bad people. And that's there's no excuse for that. That is not what, you can't find that in this book. It's about living for him, and you're missing out. Not only are you missing out on life, but your children are missing out on life when you do that. That's why so many of the kids, when they turn 18, they just ditch God altogether, because they didn't see anything real in your life. They didn't see that adventure, and you didn't put yourself in positions where God had to come through, and then he comes through and your whole family was going, wow, that was amazing. I am never going to leave that God. No, you just created a little bubble for yourself where, how was God even going to operate in that? And I don't know. I don't want to be negative. I don't want to sound negative. I just get sad because I go, not only are you missing out on life, but we are turning away our children by the droves because our lives are not the adventure that they see in Scripture, and they are not experiencing the Holy Spirit. They're experiencing like a Christian version of the American dream that's watered down, and we just make excuses for really idolizing our families rather than really putting Christ in the mission first.
When you all first got into the room, there was an opening video that talked about a possibly dangerous message. So this is the start of it. You'll see as the night progresses why I played this for you. But this was something that crossed my radar about 2 weeks ago that devastated me. And I had to share it with you. Like I said, you'll understand more of why I played it as the night goes on. But I will say this: I want to be that church. I want to be that church. I want to be the church that you open up the Bible, and you see this stuff, and it's not just like, wow, that was amazing how that happened. I so desperately want to be that church that people open up our door and go, wow, I can't believe that's happening. That's what I want so bad. And so I want to speak about that tonight. But it's amazing. It's not something that helps us to or makes us veer away from the current message series. God is good, and he's not a God of confusion, and it's perfectly placed. So I want to continue on in our series, The Healthy Body. This is the way it's going to go. Next week, we'll finish this series. And then the next week after that, we'll begin. We'll get back to kind of like our roots. Our roots are to preach through books of the Bible. That's always been what I believe God wanted me to do, was to just, hey, I've made a book, young man. It's perfect. You don't need to help it. Just preach it. And so we're going to get back to that. We've been away from that for a while. As the Lord laid things upon my heart to share with you, I've tried to be obedient in that. But we're going to get back to the study of a book of the Bible. We're going to dive into the book of Ephesians, which is pregnant with awesome stuff. And I would challenge you to commit to being at church every single week during that message series. And I don't know how many weeks it's going to go, but it won't be short. It is tons of good stuff, I'll say. So we're gonna do that. But tonight I want to continue on in our message series called The Healthy Body. And just to kind of back up a little bit, the whole purpose of this, I started out weeks and weeks ago saying that I believed that what God wanted for Revolution Church during this season was a season that we would become a healthy body. And a healthy body is healthy, growing, and full of love. And so we've been studying the books of the Bible that contain churches that are messed up, that started out well, and then they got sideways, and they drifted off into a ditch, and they made mistakes. And so, and I love that. Don't you love that about the Bible? Like, I love that there's bad stuff in there because it's so gritty and it's so real. You know what I mean? It's not some fairy tale where everything's just happy and peaches and cream and unicorns and bunny rabbits. No, it's like these people were kind of messed up, but he left it in there on purpose so that we could learn from their mistakes. And so we've been doing that. We went to Galatia, we saw what they did, and we went to southern Greece to the church in Corinth, and we saw what they did, and we're like, man, I don't want to do that, right? I don't want to go sideways like they did. So we learned from them, and then we ventured into the book of Revelation, when there's seven churches in there that started out well, and then they went sideways, and the Lord spoke directly in red, right? Do you think when he spoke it came out red? I don't even know. I got problems. So, but he speaks to these churches, and they're all good churches, and he encourages them at first in all of his statements, but then he says, I got an issue with you. So we study some of these issues so that we can say, hey, have we done that? And if so, we can look at the Word of God and go, hey, let's get back on track. And if we haven't done that, then maybe some preventative medicine, isn't that good, right? You put oil in that, you change the oil in the car so it won't break down. Right, and that's what we want to do too. We want to change the oil in our car so it won't break down. So we look and see, well, maybe we haven't done this, but there's some areas that we could mess up, and we don't want to do that. So we want to study the book and see where God corrects them. Are the lights all the way up? Am I just getting old? I am old. Man. Oh, there it is. Huh? It's the frost. Get up there and change them, Jared. Did you say it's freezing in here? Man. You are definitely a southern boy. There's no doubt about it. All right, once and for all, let's get this done right now. Who thinks it's good in here? Who thinks it's warm in here? Who thinks it's cold in here? So we got a 50-50 good and cold. Hold on. Let's have some fun. Hold on. Okay. Who thinks it's good? Put your hand up. Leave your hands up. Okay, take a look around you. Take a look around you. Okay, take a look around. No, don't be afraid. Don't be, hey, the new guy, it's the new guy. It's okay, you got a vote here, man. You're cold? Put your hand down. And okay, and then now put him down, and then who thinks it's cold? Is there really any difference here? All right, so listen. The temperature is set, listen, at 70. It's at 70. Can we stop talking about the air conditioning? No, I didn't. Somebody else did. Okay. Everyone say welcome, Kim. Watch this. Here, hold on, hold on. Hey, welcome, Kim. Yeah, just leave that door open. Make sure all the kids run out, man. Naughty. That naughty kid. I'm trying to reduce my lying in church. All right, listen. Let's get back to the Bible. Who has a Bible with them? You got a Bible? Awesome, awesome. Turn to Revelation chapter 2. Please put your eyes on God's Word. You know how many people have died to make sure that that book gets in your hand? Amazing, amazing. So we're going to continue on in our study. Now, Jesus, in this book, in the book of Revelation, he speaks to seven churches. In seven churches, he boldly speaks to them. And in all of these sections of Scripture in Revelation where he's speaking to these churches, there's only one unilateral statement. There's only one thing that he says to each and every one of them. And it is this. Anyone with ears to hear should listen to the Spirit and understand what he is saying to the church. Anyone with ears to hear. Now, that carries with it the idea that there are some that will not. Do you understand? Okay. There are some that will not. They will not hear his voice. And they will not follow him. They will not obey. They will not understand. Jesus said in John 10:27 that my sheep know my voice. And I know them. And they follow me. You see, they will hear the voice of God. Now remember that the Spirit never says anything unless Jesus tells them what to say. So when the Spirit speaks, it's Jesus Christ himself speaking to his disciples. And not everyone will understand it. Not everyone will hear it. But I pray that you will. I pray that you will. John 17:6, I love this. Jesus is talking to his dad. He's explaining, you know, you gave me these people and they're mine and I declared them to you. And they kept your word. Man, I want to be that. Don't you want to be that church? Don't you want to be that church that keeps his word? That, you know, we've been saying it for 6 years now. Open it, read it, and do it. You know, the world, the Christian world is filled with people that will not do as they say. They will not do what this book says. You open up the scriptures and you see what God says and you see what we do, and it's like it's a chasm between. I want to be a church that that Jesus could say, hey, you know what? Revolution Church, those people, they kept my word. Man, that would be an awesome review, wouldn't it? And can you imagine if you went to your Facebook page? You know, on our Facebook page is reviews. People review it. How awesome would that be if all of a sudden you went to the Facebook page tomorrow and you saw Jesus put up a review and it said, these are my people and they keep my word. That would be awesome. That would be awesome. So, you know, on Thursday nights, I meet with a small group of young men in this church that seem to want him. They diligently pursue Christ. I love those guys. They're my boys. I love them. And you know what we're doing? We're studying. We're doing a study. It's called Authentic. It's called Authentic. Developing the disciplines of a sincere faith. Developing the disciplines of people who will keep my word. That's what I want for this church, and I believe that's what God wants for this church right here. So, that being said, I hope you hear his voice tonight. I hope you hear his voice tonight. Revelation chapter 2 is talking to the church in Ephesus. And he says in verse 2, something we've heard before, haven't we? I know all the things you do. Everything is naked and laid bare before the one to whom we must give an account. I know all the things you do. I have seen your hard work and your patient endurance. I know you don't tolerate evil people. You have examined the claims of those who say they are apostles but are not. You've discovered they are liars. You have patiently suffered for me without quitting. And of all the churches in Revelation that I've read over the last couple weeks, I think that is Revolution Church right there. I see a church, and I've been with you guys, some of you since the beginning, but we've been together in this church for almost 6 years now. And he says, listen, I know all the things you do. I've seen your hard work and your patient endurance and how you've patiently suffered for me without quitting. There are people in this church that need, we should have them up here and applaud them for their faithful service. There are people who have been coming to this church week in and week out, serving, praying, giving, attending, pray. Like, they're awesome people. They've been praying for you. You get prayed for. And they keep doing it and doing it and doing it. And let me ask you a question. Has it been weeks, like about 3-4 weeks ago, when there was 17 people here? Now, you don't look at a church after 6 years and see 17 people in your seats and go, wow, that's a massive success. And we can get all super spiritual. But I mean, let's be real for a little bit, right? If you're the pastor of the church and you look out after 6 years and you see 17 people in the room, you're not going, wow, this is rocking. This is going well, right? But look at the word here. Look at God's word, man. Forget what you, listen, there's one of these songs. Forget what you see. I declare right now that I no longer see empty seats. Join me. No more. We got to believe in what God says, not what we see. He says, I've seen your hard work, your patient endurance. Like you've been waiting. You've been working. These next couple of claims about, you know, false teaching, false prophets, false doctrine, you don't deal with that. And there's been people since our ministry started that came into this church that had differing views. And look, they come and you've stayed strong to God's word. And so I commend everyone in this room right now who has stuck with God's word. And didn't fly off in every little wind of teaching that came that sounded good and it was exciting and experiential. You know, you stuck with God's word. And that's what the Bible says here. You stuck with it. You suffered for me without quitting. This is Revolution Church, I believe. Remember, he says, listen to the Spirit and understand what he's saying to the church. Not just to this church in Ephesus, but to his church. So it could definitely be for us. But look what he says. But. Ooh. Say that with me. Ooh. But I have this complaint against you. You don't love me or each other as you did at first. Look how far you have fallen. Turn back to me and do the works you did at first. Now, I love the New Living Translation. I've been preaching out of it for 12 years. But this translation is not really good. But you will see as the night progresses why it was translated this way. You'll see it's like half true. It's half true. But if you do me a favor, if you've got a translation, a New Living, or any other translation, you're probably going to see either New Living down at the bottom, another translation for that verse, or in another Bible, you're going to see really the proper one. And it's not that you don't love me or each other as you did at first. That talks about time, right? No, it's you have lost your first love. That's the proper I didn't even know what I'm saying. Interpretation of the verse. Now let's talk about this, your first love. The word first here in this text is the Greek word protos. And it doesn't mean first, as in the first time. We've loved lots of things in our life, right? Way back when you were a little kid, you loved you had a certain toy that you loved, didn't you? I have a little toy. I still have it. Adriana has it now. It's a little teddy bear. It's the first toy I ever had. He's a little white bear with a bell in his ear, and he's fallen apart. And his name, I don't even know why I named him, but I named him E-Bear. His name is E, the letter E. I loved that little toy. That was my first love. Sequential, right? Chronological. That was my first love. And I loved a lot of things along the way, haven't you? That's not what it's talking about. It's the word first is protos. It's not first in sequence. It's foremost in importance. That's how it's defined. It's not first in time. It's first of all. Like if you were going to explain something to someone and you had something important you wanted to tell them, it was a bunch of stuff, and you're like, well, first of all, right, you'd give them the big thing first, like the most important thing. First of all is this, and that's how this is defined. You've lost your first love, your first of all love, not a chronological love, but a prioritized according to importance love. And so the question beckons, what is the Christian's first love? What's the most important love? What's the first of all love? Well, there's something in the Bible that we call the Great Commandment, and it's not the Great Commandment by any means. It's not labeled by God the Great Commandment. It's just what we call it, but this is the most important love. It's the most important word that God has ever given to man, and I welcome you to put your eyes upon it in Mark chapter 12. And it will tell you what your first love is, your first of all love, your most important love. Tell me when you're there. Second, okay. 12:29. Jesus says, listen, O Israel. Do you know what Israel is? Just euphemistic for God's people. You're Israel. If you've put your faith in Jesus Christ for eternal life, then you are Israel, right? Just as much as I am, who I'm Jewish by blood, if you are in Christ, you are Israel. Do you understand? And so listen, O Israel, all of you. The Lord our God is the one and only Lord, and you must love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, and all your strength. The second is equally important. This next statement is just as important as the first, and that's to love your neighbor as yourself. Now, the reason why this is the first of all love, the most important love, is that it's the only love that encompasses every aspect of your being. It commands all of you. And Paul said to give yourself as a living sacrifice unto God. This is what he's talking about. To love him with your mind, like your thoughts should be fixed upon him. Like, I love you, Lord. I love your praise will ever be on my lips. Like, I love you. I'm thinking about the Lord. I'm meditating on his word day and night. That's what I'm thinking about. My heart, to love him with my whole heart. That's where my feelings are and my emotions and my choices come from. My heart, is my heart beating for the gospel? Am I feeling the pain of the people who are lost? Am I driven by your love? That's my heart, my soul. Love him with your whole soul. That means a complete and lasting. Your soul is the only thing about you that lasts forever. So is your love a lasting and complete committed love of the Lord? And how about your strength? What are you expending your energy on? Are you expending your energy on the pursuit of a love relationship with the Lord? Are you using your energy and your strength and your vitality to pursue the Lord? And then in the same fashion, to love other people. This is mind-blowing. And this is your first of all love of the Christ follower. Okay, Jesus, I love you. Ba, 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 ba. Did you ever tell a person in high school that you loved them? Did you mean it?
Yeah.
Right, good answer. He only told Candy he loved her. That's it. Liar. I need some water. You definitely get dinner tonight, at very least. That's good. Right. So what I'm saying is, right, you can say it, right? You can say it all day. Lots of people say they love Jesus. They also say they love baseball. They love Ford. They love Chevy. They love Dodge. They love Kawasaki. I mean, come on. I love dogs. I love cats. Almost means nothing anymore, doesn't it? Okay, Jesus, I love you. Well, guess what? Jesus has a way of gauging that. Did you know that? He says here, I know all the things you do. So he sees beyond your little lip service. They praise me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me, see? So he has a way of knowing if what you say is what you mean. John 14, 15 says this, if you love me, you will keep my commands. Bless you. That's the person that loves Jesus. The ones who open it, read it, and do it, and do it. He wants you to keep his commands. He wants you to show him that you love him. The Bible over and over and over again says this, Ephesians 4:1, to live a life worthy of your calling. Philippians 1:22, I believe, to live a life in a manner worthy of the good news. Colossians 1:10, to live in a way worthy of the Lord. So that's why James will tell us in the book named, take a wild guess, James. You guys are awesome. He tells us to not just be hearers of the word, but to be doers of the word. Do you know that Jesus never said, now go and memorize scripture? He said, go and do what scripture says. That's what he said. Down with empty words and declarations, and up with actions that reflect true love. Revelation 3:2 says, I find that your actions don't meet the requirements of my God. Too many people are living a fake life. They're really not loving the Lord. They're really not in obedience to him. They may call themselves Christians. They may wear Christian t-shirts and have Christian mugs, but when the rubber meets the road, they're not following his commands. And so they can't honestly say they love him. Well, how do we obediently display this amazing, overwhelming love for God and other people? Well, just like the Great Command is not really something from Scripture, the name of it, well, the Great Commission is not either. But it's what we call what Jesus told you to do. Not just me, but what he told you to do. It's the Great Commission. This is what he said. He said, I want you to love the Lord God with all your mind, heart, soul, and strength, and the way you do it is to keep my command. Here's my command to you. You ready for my command? Yeah, I know, most people aren't. All authority has been given to me, he said, in heaven and in earth. Now, where's that?
Everywhere.
So, who's above him? No one. No one, listen to me, loved ones. No one can tell you anything contrary to what I'm about to tell you. It cannot trump what Jesus is going to tell you right now. Do you understand? No one can tell you not to obey him. And no one can tell you that it's wrong because he is the boss. And he said, all authority has been given to me everywhere. Now go make disciples and baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teach them all that I have taught you. And remember this, I'll be with you. Now listen, that's empowering. But it's also scary because he knows all the things that you do. He told you what to do. And I'm calling it this church out right now. Are you showing your love for him with all your mind, heart, soul, and strength? Are you obeying the one thing, the most important thing he told you to do? Are you doing it? Don't answer. Don't answer. I just jotted this down. You will prove your love of God by obeying the call to go. You will, listen, you will prove your love to God by obeying the call to go, and you will prove your love for the other people by offering them the greatest gift that you could ever give them. If you want to love them, give them the greatest gift that's available to you. And I'm telling you, church, listen up. If this, what I'm talking about right now, is not the single most important thing in your very existence, then the word in Revelation 2 applies to you. Look how far you have fallen. This is his greatest command right now. Love me with all your mind, heart, soul, and strength, and do this, display this thing by obeying my command to go reach a lost and hurting world. Go! That's what he said. Go. You've lost your first love. Now, how do you know if you're being obedient? I could sit up here and yell at you all day, but listen, listen. Listen. What's your schedule look like? Now, this is the time to look at yourself. Just let God's word be the mirror in front of your face. Don't really even look at me. Ask these questions of yourself. If I'm to love the Lord God with all my mind, heart, soul, and strength, everything about me is supposed to be for this thing, what's my schedule look like? How much time in his word am I spending? Down with reading plans that squeeze God's in for 10 minutes in the morning. Throw that garbage in the trash where it belongs. This is God's very word. The creator of heaven and earth spoke and put it down here for you. Do you know that he doesn't need this? He is the word. You do. We need this word. It's nourishment for our soul. What's your schedule look like? How much time are you gathering with believers? Are you doing it often and consistently? This isn't the word for you that have chosen to come tonight. You're being obedient. That's good. It's the other folks that are, you know, on occasion, sometimes. How about your prayer life? Guilty. Anyone else guilty? It's a house of love. You can admit it. You confess your sin to each other, we find healing. I need it. How much time in your schedule are you doing what it says in Hebrews? Not just to come to church and gather, but before you get here, how much time are you thinking of ways to motivate one another to love and good deeds? How much time did you spend this week being obedient? That's how you show your love for him, right? How much time did you spend this week thinking of ways to encourage me or Mimi or Eileen or Jay or Ken or Roger or Cassidy, any of you? How much time did you spend thinking of ways to motivate them to love and good deeds? And then coming here tonight, Cassidy, I was thinking about you this week and there's something I think you could do and I pour it out. And how much time did you do? Listen, any? How much time have you spent serving your family of faith here at Revolution? Where do your resources flow? You know, the Bible says that all good things come from above. David, after announcing his giving and the giving of the people that I shared with you earlier, he broke out in praise. And in 1 Chronicles chapter 29, he says, and I think this speaks directly to where your resources flow. O Lord, the God of our ancestor Israel, may you be praised forever and ever. Yours, O Lord, is the greatness, the power, the glory, the victory, and the majesty. Everything in heaven and on earth is yours, O Lord, and this is your kingdom. We adore you as the one who is over all things. Listen, wealth and honor come from you alone. Power and might are in your hand, and at your discretion, people are made great and given strength. Oh, our God, we thank you. This is the King. This is the King speaking. Oh, our God, we thank you and praise your glorious name. But who am I and who are my people that we could give anything to you? Everything we have has come from you, and we give you only what you first gave us. Where do your resources flow? Are you the Dead Sea where God puts in a little bit and it stops? Or does he give to you and you joyfully and willingly and cheerfully invest it right back into the kingdom of God so his purposes can advance? Or are you stingily holding on to the little that you have, thinking somehow you made it? You made nothing. Any skill you have to make a dollar was given to you by the Almighty. If you can build anything, him. If you can play anything, him. If you can sing anything, him. If you can preach anything, definitely him. All from him. Where do your resources flow? And this stuff here, this recalibrating of our life back to the first love, to advancing the kingdom of God, this is not normal. It's not normal, is it? It's not normal at all. Hence the name of our church, Revolution, a sudden and momentous shift in the status quo. We got to be different. Everything we do should be motivated by this love, and it should display this love. Who we are, where we are, what we do. Listen, loving Jesus enough to obey him and loving people enough to share him, right? That's it. That's everything. That's church. That's the reason we exist. It's the reason we exist personally. It's the reason why we exist as a church family, is to love him enough to obey him and love the people enough to share him. That's why we exist. That's why your heart beats another minute. It's for that. Now, I'm challenging the church here tonight. I'm challenging you to let God's word speak to you. What you've heard, I'm done. What you've heard, this is why you exist. And this is the church we're supposed to be. You get it? Loving the Lord God with all your mind, heart, soul, and strength, by obeying him and then going to the people who don't know him yet and sharing him. That's it. That's why we exist. And I'm challenging you to recalibrate your life and recapture this thing. Do you know, this church, that's how it started. Years ago, on the highway, that's who we were. We loved God and we loved people. We love people that churches didn't love. We love people that were outcasts, the scum of the earth. Everyone hated these people, the tattooed, long-haired freaks, single moms with a bunch of kids that society looked down on, poor, homeless, hurting, just busted up people. And we loved them so much. I'm going to say it. We were ballsy, and we went out on the highway, and we put up a billboard that said, "We love you. Jesus loves you. And so we want to be just like Jesus, and we want to love you too."
And you have a place where you can come and you can be a part of a family. And that's what we did. That's who we are. And we got to get back. He said, remember your first love. That was our first love. We displayed our love for him and for the people right there. And he said, I want you to turn back and repent and do the things you once did. That's the problem here. We're not doing that anymore. We got to get back to that. We got to get back to that. And so I'm challenging you to renew your focus. And if this could be a renewed focus, I want to tell you this, that I believe with all my heart that God has divinely moved to help us express this devotion to him and this love for him with all of our mind, heart, soul, and strength, and our love for people. I believe that he's done something mighty so that we have the opportunity to live out this first of all love in an extraordinarily impactful way. So I'd like to welcome up Dan Johnson. You guys all know Dan. Yeah, he's good looking, right? Yeah. And Dan is going to, he's going to tell you some things. See if I can get this thing to work. Hello? Is it on mute?
Hello? Giddy up, boom, ba, boom, ba, 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 ba.
He wants to tell you Hello. About some stuff. Huh?
Is it hot in here? Is the AC broke? Is it? Okay. I don't want to start that again. I'm not starting that again. I'm hot. Just. All right. As you can tell, I think there's an announcement coming. But let me read Revelations 3, 15 and 16. I know your deeds, that you are neither cold nor hot. I wish that you were cold or hot. So because you are lukewarm and neither hot nor cold, I will spit you out of my mouth. How long have we been in Eustace? Like 2.5 years? I remember the old building was pretty hopping. Stuff was always going on. We moved here. I'm not blaming it on anything, but since we've been here, we've gotten stagnant, boring. You know, like enthusiasm's kind of down here. I'm saying Mike DiGiacomo's, no. So, but who would agree? Would anybody agree? You know, that we were kind of, we've gotten stale? All right. So, and also before I say this, I want to bring up, and this should give it away here, but remember the building that we looked at in downtown Eustis, right? That didn't pan out. That was like months. It when you're up here, or when you're out there, you know, you hear, oh, we're moving. And there's like, oh, shocker, you know? But there was actually months of preparation and stuff going on for that. There was a signed lease and everything when we were going, when that was announced, we were going, and it was a done deal. But something happened. Even after we signed the lease, there was some business activity. That building was getting in the process of being sold, and the people buying the property didn't want tenants in that building. Even though we had a signed lease, we could have fought that and said, hey, you know, we got a signed lease, we're going in. I think that would have turned out probably bad in the long run. And the people buying that building are Christians, at least one of them that I know is, and is a friend of this church. And let me see. I wanted to read a different one. 1 Corinthians, anyway, I'm going to paraphrase it because I don't have it written down. No, I do right here. All right. When one of you has a dispute with another believer, how dare you file a lawsuit and ask a secular court to decide the matter instead of taking it to the other believers. So instead of fighting it like a bunch of brats and saying, we want our way, we have a lease signed. We decided to just let it be and say, okay, it's an understandable situation. We understand that the building needed to be sold. Somebody wanted the building, and it worked out good for them, and we were still here. But that didn't stop us from wanting to try to do something different, to get into another place. So the Lord has opened some doors, and it's giving me chills thinking about it. But so for me, it feels like it's time to re-energize this church, re-energize ourselves, and to get motivated to reach out, to do all the stuff that Moses just preached about that I don't do all the time. We're stagnant, I think. Not all of us, but a lot of us are really stuck in a rut. And one of those things that kind of brings you out of a rut is doing something different. It's something that can bring people together to put their skills and their resources together and make new relationships and do something to move forward and something to feel like you're reaching out. Y'all tell where I'm going with this? Is it getting obvious yet? Seriously? Mike's back there. No. I believe it. Mike doesn't know. So anyway, you want to put this picture up? Yeah, we're moving to New York where it snowed a foot this month. You're like, no, we're not. Hold on, there's a picture coming up. But there's an opportunity. There's an opportunity, and I'm going to leave the details for Moses. But this Home Depot building. Now you see the Home Depot, how many square feet you think that is? It's not that, it's the one next to it. You see where the Family Fun Center was, where the laser tag and stuff was? That's like a 10,000 square foot building that is set up pretty cool. And I there's so many things, this building kind of came to us like months ago, somewhere over the summer, back a while ago. Put it to the side, it came back on the table, we put it to the side again, it kept coming back and back and back, and it just like over and over, a ridiculous amount, it just kept coming back to us. So at a certain point, how many times do you shut the door on God and you know, you just, sometimes you just gotta go. And so this is the front of the building, right? You have the next picture? This is the, it's beautiful. We've already done all the work to it. Mike painted.
I was going to say it was professionally done by Jared.
I was just going to say this. I was working on that. Mike was working for Scanlon Renovation. Little plug for you, buddy. You could throw me some cash later. But this is the front from about here forward is where a sanctuary would be. And we've actually had an architect do draw plans and everything to meet the city code. This has been months going on, and a lot of people have pulled the resources together in their time within the church and people out of the church that have no idea who we are. They just are Christians and they want to do what they can do. There's been a lot of stuff that I'll let Moses tell about that has been done, but the architect was one of them, awesome guy. And there's another picture. There's one picture missing, but this is the back of the building where the loading dock is, and that looks like Meredith. So where that wall ended, there's another wall, and there's, how many square feet is that back? 2,000 square feet of a warehouse in the back that would be for children and stuff that has ceilings as high as the back, like that's how high the ceilings are. So there's tons of room there. I don't think we have a picture of the inside of the back, but it's pretty cool. There's like tons of room. And we've had, just amazing things that have been done so far. I'm actually just going to ask Moses to tell all that because I think he's got it upstairs, remembers it a little better than I do. So here you go.
Wow. Okay. There was a three and a half,
3.5, 4 years ago, we left the UMAC in Tavares and we found a little building that was just awful. And we all came together and we renovated this place because we wanted to do more together as a family. And we wanted to be able to reach the community. We were in a place that didn't, no one knew we were there. We didn't have a sign. I mean, it was just kind of tough, kind of tucked away. And we went there and you could see there was a season when we were just a really thriving church. I remember being in the building and it was standing room only. And it was a small place, but it was an awesome place. And it was incredible. We couldn't fit any people in there. And there were so many kids that if DCF had come, they would have shut us down. You guys remember the trailer? Who remembers the trailer? We had a old busted up fifth wheel tucked behind the building for an extra classroom. We were putting kids in there. Like, they would have arrested us. Arrested my wife, not me. But I said she was hot. And so, but anyways, it was a, yeah, lie. So anyway, it was good times. And the band was up. We were praying earlier before we came out. And Ben mentioned when we renovated and it was fun. Smashing walls and just it was incredible. It was fun. Yeah, the gun hammer. Yeah. Anyway, it was a good time. It was a time when the church really came together as a family and saw a common vision of what could be. We walked into a building that was just ratty and gross, and it had cigarette racks and porno magazine racks, and it was just gross. It had rats in it, and it was just disgusting. But there was a vision. You could see what could be. You could see what it could possibly be, and you could see a busy road where there was people, and you could reach people there. You know what I'm saying? A place where people could come and meet Jesus and his people, and you could meet that. You know, it was just really a neat place, and it was busy, and we came here, and this was a good place. We needed a place to go when we left that place. We had no. If you remember, we had no place to go. Remember, no place to go. And I was like, guys, bring the trucks and trailers. Remember, and they're like, well, where are we going? I don't even know. But we're going somewhere, right? I felt like Abraham. Like, I don't even know. So, and all of a sudden, this building, it became known to us. It was available. So it was the right time, right price, right size. We did it, and it was awesome. Some great things have happened while we're here. It hasn't been a loss. We started a harmony group where the pastors get together, and we love one another. We do things together. We pray for each other. We serve in each other's churches. We do joint ventures together to the community. We're crossing Orange Avenue so that the racial divide is gone. Like, and listen, God used your church for that. It was your church that initiated that group. And that group lives on. And there's been talk in the group lately about expanding beyond Eustis. Why? Why would you just have Eustis? Why wouldn't you just include the whole body of Christ when you're a member of the body of Christ, right? You're a member at any church. I'm a member of the church across the street. You guys know that? I'm Presbyterian. No, I'm not. But I could be. I could wear a robe. But we're all a body, so we want to kind of come together. So that's been good. We've seen people give their life to Christ here. We've had many people baptized here. We have a lot of people that serve faithfully here. It's been some amazing events. We've had great concerts, great music, great praise, great worship time, great fellowship with one another. I mean, it's been tremendous for sure. But I have to agree with Dan, there's been a little bit of a lull. I think that the gospel, the default posture of the gospel saved Christian is go. Would you agree? It's go. And so I want to go, so much of my brain. Almost 13 years ago, I was in my house in where is now Blair's bedroom, and I began to write. And I wrote what God had given me for a vision for the church that I would pastor someday. And it was called Your Kingdom Come. It was two and a quarter pages. And one of the lines in it was that God's church was never intended to be little groups of people down little side streets in little buildings that no one knew about. And we moved here, and it was good. I love it here. It's a beautiful place. It really is. But when God gives a vision, that's what you're supposed to do. I wasn't being disobedient intentionally. I don't know. We needed a place to go. This is beautiful. So we moved. Habakkuk chapter 2, I read this years and years ago. I didn't even know that it spoke to me till yesterday.
God said to Habakkuk the prophet, "This vision is for a future time. It describes the end, and it will be fulfilled. If it seems slow in coming, wait patiently, for it will surely take place. It will not be delayed." This was almost 13 years ago that I penned that. And here we are, given an opportunity to go to a place that can truly impact the community. One of the downfalls to this place here is that there's some shortcomings, parking and down a little side street, all that. But I will say this about this community: it's well covered by Gospel Works. Within a quarter mile of where we sit right now, there's 7 gospel churches, 7 Bible-believing, Bible-preaching churches. This community is well covered. We need to help them. But that place right there, that's the busiest location in our community, is it not? Thousands of people congregate, come and go there, stores, restaurants, banks, the mall, Home Depot, Lowe's, all these places, this entire marketplace. And guess how many churches are right there in the middle of all this? 1. Down a little side street, just like this. I didn't even know it was there until I became friends with Jessica and Tim. It's down in their little neighborhood. There's no churches, really. Yeah. In that immediate marketplace, there's 1. So the opportunity to reach people in a great way has presented itself. Now, like Dan said, it came to our attention months ago. I actually called it because I thought of another church, a friend of mine, that needed some more space. And so I called it for him, and it didn't work out for him because he needed more space than this. And I just let it die. About 3-4 weeks later, I called Dan. I'm like, "Dan, are we missing the mark here? Is this?" He's like, "Yeah, I thought you gave up on that a little too easily for you." I was like, "I don't know, man." Well, my wife, she said, "Moses, you want to know how? Just pray. Just pray. Just say, God, if this is what you want, you got to open up doors. You got to make something happen." Listen, I'm going to be very transparent with you. We got $4,000 in the bank. It's going to be more than that. But let me tell you what's going on here. Nothing short of miraculous what's happened here. Amazing. She said, "Pray, and if he wants you there, he'll open up the doors. If he doesn't, he'll slam it in your face. Are you good with that?" I said, "It's fine. We got a beautiful place. It's all good. I don't care." So we did. We just prayed. So the first thing I did is, "All right, Dan, let's just go. Let's go meet with the city, because, you know, we've had issues before, right?" So we went with the city. It's zoned properly. It has the right fire alarm, and it's completely sprinklered. Okay. They were enthusiastic about us being there. They said, "We're going to make it simple for you. We would like you there." The planning director is a Christian. He's like, "I'll be praying for you guys." Like, come on. Well, the first thing you need to do is you need to submit some plans to us. You need an architect. You can't draw it yourself. "Well, who am I going to call?" He goes, "Well, I can't tell you who to call, but here's some people you should call." Right? Call this guy. So he gives us a list of people. I called the first one. It just so happened that this guy named Chris is a pastor. So I call him and I said, "Well, could you come down to the building and just give me a quick look and tell me if you think it's possible for this to even happen?" He goes, "All right, I'll meet you down there." So he meets me down there a couple days later, whatever. He walks in, walks around. I'm already freaking out. We don't have enough money for his bill, never mind the rest of it. You know, it's thousands for an architect, right? I'm like, "So what's that going to cost?" He goes, "You know what? I believe the Lord wants you here. My services are free." Crazy, right? Okay, that's the way it started. So we started drawing. Well, we needed a general contractor. Wish we could just go there and do it ourselves, right? Doesn't happen that way. Well, the man who owns this building, who bought that other building out from underneath us that we were angry about, I went to him and I said, "Would you be our general contractor and let us do the work?" He's like, "No way. Someone gets hurt on that job, my 25-year company is gone." I understand. Wind out of the sails. I was okay with it.
Okay, we're done. It's okay. Until he called me back. All right, Moses, I'll do it. But you got to get licensed plumber, licensed HVAC, licensed electrician, licensed sprinkler guys. I need real people with real permit pulling ability and doing real work. Then I'll do it. Okay, I'll go to work. First thing was a plumber. You know, I've been good friends with Andy and his wife, Bruni, for 15 years. This guy's been telling me about this guy named Papa Joe since day one. His spiritual father. His mentor. I've never met the guy. About a month ago, they invited us, Meredith and I, over to their house for a worship night. We're just going to sit around, 5, 6, 7, 8 people. We're just going to sing songs to Jesus, eat a little food. You know, just scale down model of what we're doing right here. So we went. Papa Joe's there. Awesome, I get to meet the guy. So I'm like, hey, how you doing? Nice to meet you finally. Tell me what you do at your church. Well, I'm an elder. I do this. Oh, is that all you do? He goes, well, no, I own a plumbing company. And oh, hold on. You don't think I need to know this? So I talked to him, right? Let's fast forward. We've had several conversations of what it would cost. First, yeah, listen, I happen to have the architecture plans with me that night because I want us to pray. God, is this what you want? It's got to be, right? So I laid out the plans in front of him, and he's like, well, do that, $1,800 for plumbing. Okay, I don't know if that's good. I go back to our general contractor guy. I'm like, $1,800 for plumbing? He's like, that's an amazing number. That's an amazing number. Well, we've changed plans since then, and we tripled the size of the bathroom. And the other day on the phone, he agreed that to build that bathroom is going to be $7,000. But if Andy will do the work for me, give me $800, we'll call it a day. Awesome, right? Plumber, solved. The general contractor said the electrician's going to be the largest cost involved. Well, needless to say, we have a plumber who's a Christian, an electrician who's a Christian and doesn't want anything for it, said he'll pull the permit, and oh, how about Tim Murata, who's an electrician? Right? Could probably put in a plug, right? Maybe? Electrician. Listen, electrician, free. How about some drywall? We got to put some walls up and do some drywall, right? Well, guess what Andy does for a living? He's a drywall tech. He's been doing it for how long? Yeah, 15 years. Free. Oh, but they're going to have to buy the drywall, right? So Andy had heard about a pastor that had maybe 20 boards at his church that maybe they would donate. So call these people, he says. So I call up this lady, Jennifer, who's the pastor's sister, and she says, well, how much do you need to build the whole thing? I'm just curious. And I told her the number. She goes, well, I'm just going to donate all of it to you. Free drywall. Free drywall installation. Well, we're going to need to put some air conditioning into the bathrooms. So I called a gentleman that I know, Rapture Air. Don't worry about it, Moses. I got it. We're going to bless you. No cost. So the last thing that needed to be done, work-wise, was these walls needed to be built. Well, the decision was made that we were going to execute the lease on May 1st and begin to build. But there was one more thing that needed to be done. We needed to frame the walls. That means we got to pay the general contractor because we don't have anyone for that. Until I was talking to Kyle on the phone, and he goes, oh, well, I'm just happened to be there on May 4th through the 10th, so just get me all the wood and I'll frame it for free. So I sent him the plans. He's like, I got this. I can do that in a day. It's not much. So now that's free. Another thing. The general contractor that owns this building, I've never seen anything like this in my life. The general contractor who owns this building, who we didn't sue and go after because he stole our building, who's allowing us to do this, and he's going to oversee the project. When you have an assembly in a building, you have to have a high-low water fountain. Do you know what I'm talking about? Yeah. uncooled, they're $800 a piece. He called me last week and says, hey, you know what? I have two of those in my storage unit. I'll just give them to you. That's $1,600 free. Part of the plans is we have to have partitions for office and children's ministry. We're not building walls for that. The county's, the city's allowing us to do that. Anyone have a price? Partition walls? Price, not carry. Okay, they're very expensive. So about a month ago, I was, maybe this will happen, maybe not. I don't know, but for it to happen, we got to consider the cost first, right? You got to see if we can do this. So I'm contacting people on Craigslist about these walls. They're very expensive. And I contact them, do you still have them? Yes. Do you want to buy them? Maybe. Don't know yet. Don't want them in my garage. Don't want to spend money for a place that's not going to work. Because listen, it didn't work before, right? Right now, we've got the lease in hand. We've got the architecture stamped. And a meeting with the city Monday. Like, it's all in place, but we haven't moved in yet. But I'm just waiting to see if God wants us to do something, right? So one of the things that we need was office partitions. They're thousands of dollars. So I'm putting these people off. I don't know if I can buy it. So we put it off. A week and a half ago, maybe, 2 weeks ago, I get an email from a lady at GP Solutions in Titusville, an aerospace engineering firm. Mr. Robbins, would you be interested if we donated all of this equipment to your church? All the walls? Sure. So we grabbed trucks and trailers, and thank you to all who allowed this and offered their services and their trucks and trailers. We went down there and got three trailer loads, and when we were there, she said, you know, we just bought this stuff a couple years ago for $20,000, and they donated all of it for free. Not only that, but my, I don't know if you know this, but if you've gone upstairs at all, our children's furniture is trashed. 4.5 years of being beat on by these kids. So my wife's been praying, Lord, please, we need furniture. We can't afford it. We need it. Guess what came in the load? 8 perfect, untouched, not a pencil mark, rectangle, thick pressed wood, you know, with the rounded corners and rounded edges for nursery tables. 8 of them, brand new. 7 of the triangle ones where the teacher goes in here and the little kids sit around, they do story time, brand new, they're not even touched. Donated over $20,000 worth of stuff. Donated to the church. Awesome. I wonder if God's doing something. So listen. To do this, you got to count the cost. To do what we want to do, to build out the architectural drawing as it sits, with all the bills that we would have, even though it's been amazing, it will cost $10,550. $10,550. When we went to the landlord to find out about the building, he said, we will give you 6 months free rent. Guess how much that equals? $10,500. So, one last thing. If you wonder if us being in this community has made a difference, to make this a possibility, we would have to have free rent because we don't have enough money to do it, right? Well, I don't want to stop worshiping with you. So I called Leon across the street at the Presbyterian Church. I said, Leon, is there any chance we could use your, he's got 2 sanctuaries over there. Could we use your sanctuary for May so we can have free rent and then build it out? Because it'll take about a month to do. It's a very simple plan. The general contractor said, this is a 4-day thing. How can you do it? That's just what it is. So
would you do that? He said, so at first he goes, yeah. I said, well, you know, because that's right there. You all park there anyway. It's easy. He says, yeah, you can have it for free. Awesome. Kingdom-minded, right? We got together. But we're still going to have to pack up our stuff into storage and then move it into the new place, move worship centers. I mean, it's kind of a lot of work. Until he texts me the other day. Now, you won't believe this. He texts me the other day. He goes, how much is your rent at the place you're at right now? I said, $1,750. He goes, well, let's just make it easier on you guys. We'll just pay for your rent in May. Are you kidding me? I said, I want to make out with you right now. He said, we're not that kind of Presbyterian. So, that's what if you look at my phone, I said, okay, how about you, will you settle for a Christian kiss? He said, all right. So that was cool. So here's the thing. An opportunity to invade a space that doesn't really have a gospel work going on in an aggressive way. There is one church, not downplaying it in any way. And we need to be a good neighbor to them. But it's not saturated with churches. It's the busiest environment in our immediate world. There's a lot of people. And if the gospel is anything, it's about reaching people with the good news. And so rather than begging someone to come where you are, I believe the biblical posture, the gospel posture, is to go where they are. And so I believe just from praying God yes or no, do you want it, do you not? I believe what I've just laid before you, I believe it's a clear answer. But I want to do what God wants. I just want to move where he wants us to move. And it's still, until we go in there and start painting stuff, it's still up to him. It's still up to him. So what I'd like to do with you is yes, I believe this is the Lord moving. I think that he's made it quite clear. He's made provision like I've never, ever seen before. When we built that little building, when we built that out and made it nice, he did crazy things there. But I've never seen anything like this. In all my years of life, in 47 years, and I've never seen the unexplained so strong in front of me. I've never seen anything like this. We literally had no way to make this happen. And I believe that it is the Lord who made this happen. I believe it is his will for this to get done. Because I think that there's people, like Jesus said, there's people that are sheep that are not yet in my flock, and I gotta go get them. And so we gotta go get them. I'm asking you to check your heart and see if it beats with the gospel. Anyone with ears to hear should listen to the Spirit and understand what he's saying to the church. My sheep will hear my voice. I know them, and they will follow me. And I want to pray in that way now. And I want to ask you to pray with me. And then we're going to sing one more song, and we're going to call it a night. And I want you to dream big. I want you to dream what God could do in this church through you people that he's blessed and loved. Let's pray. Father, I am overwhelmed. I am overwhelmed with the way you have moved. These last few months have been insane. It's been crazy. The unseen God becoming so seen. Showing yourself strong, displaying your mighty power. I'm reminded of the children of Israel who met the Red Sea dead on and had nowhere to go. How can this happen, God? How could this happen? The scriptures say that God knew there was a path there the whole time. And you made a way when it seemed like there was no way. And just like that, Lord,
where it seemed like there was no way, you made a way. You did things we can't possibly do. You're asking us to go to a place that's scary. You're asking us to do something that may not seem, like Francis said earlier, logical. But Lord, we're ready to be a church that says to the people who wonder, what's God doing over there? That we look at them and go, we don't know. It's just God. He showed up and did some incredible things. And it was not on the preacher, it wasn't on the elders, it's not the amazing band, it was God. Like, I don't understand it, it's crazy. We want that to be our church, Lord. We're ready, we wanna be that kind of church. The word says that the one who began a good work would continue to do so until the day of Christ Jesus. And I believe that's a word for our church here tonight. You began a good work years ago, and you will continue to do so until you come back to collect your bride. Lord, help us to be good stewards of that which you've given us. Help us to fall in love with you more. Help us to love you with all our mind, our heart, our soul, and our strength. Help us to display this love for you by radically obeying your command to go. Help us love the people of our community so much that we are willing to tirelessly, selflessly sacrifice of ourselves and our resources that they might have life. Anything that stands in confrontation right now to your gospel, I pray, Father God, that you would knock it dead. Anything that is in our mind, our heart, our soul, or in our strength that opposes the work of the gospel, knock it dead. I pray the blood of Jesus, the blood of success, the success blood, the prosperity blood, the protection blood of Jesus over this church, Lord. You want us to be effective in reaching the community, and we want that. Use us, Lord. Help us to meditate day and night on your word. Help us to think about ways we can motivate one another to love and good deeds. Help us to be joyful givers, to be faithful servants. We want to serve you, Lord. Help us to reflect back on the gospel that saved us. Help us think of those that have not yet given their life over to you, that are struggling and hurting and hopeless and helpless. Let them be our focus. Lord, we don't want to go anywhere without you. If you will not go, we will not go. If this is not what you want, slam that door closed. But Lord, if this is what you want, bust open the windows of heaven and pour your blessing upon this move. Lord, you are the God of miracles. Lord, you are the God of miracles. You are the same yesterday, today, and forever. And so, Lord, just like you did in days of old, where you did miraculous things that we read about, we are thankful for the miraculous things you've done thus far to make this a reality, and we ask you as your sons and daughters to continue to pour out your blessing upon this church. Display your mighty power that we might praise you greatly. In Jesus' name, amen.